Well, what a delightful occasion this is, and what a privilege to be able to share it. Thank you very much. I enjoyed the 25th anniversary of this wonderful institution. Unlike some people here, I wasn't able to enjoy the 0th anniversary. Unlike a different set of people here, it's extremely unlikely that I will enjoy the 75th anniversary. Now, we all like to speak about what we have discovered yesterday, and I'm no exception, but I'm not going to do that. I'm going to give a talk which, like several of the talks here, is historical, and there's a reason for choosing the particular topic which will become apparent, and it'll become very clear at the very end. So here's the title, Divergent Series. Now, infinite series are the basis for a wide class of approximations in mathematics and physics. We all practicing scientists know this. You guess something or you have a little theory of something and then you improve it and you improve it and you improve it and get closer to whatever it is you're trying to calculate. Now, most series are divergent. Convergent series are not interesting. Okay. Now, divergent series are the deepest area in asymptotics. Asymptotics is the study of limits. And limits in physics are usually singular. Now, singular limits themselves lie at the heart of relations between physical theories at different levels, quantum and classical, geometrical optics, wave optics, and there are many, many, many examples, slowly varying systems versus static systems, and so on. These are all singular. Now, understanding divergence has been a thread running through mathematics for several centuries, and the subject has been repeatedly reborn more deeply each time, and it's happening again now. Now, Thomas Bayes is better known for Bayesian statistics, but he submitted a paper in 1747, which was not published until 1763, after he died. That's a long, long time lag, and it didn't have the archive in those days. Well, here's the paper as he submitted it, and they didn't use tech, nor do I, by the way. And the paper was published, and in it he expressed bewilderment that a series that mathematicians were familiar with was not convergent. He was very puzzled by this. It's a series involving a large parameter, Z, but the whole series can never properly express any quantity at all, because after the fifth term, the coefficients begin to increase, and they afterwards increase at a greater rate than what can be compensated by the increase of the powers of Z, though Z represent a number ever so large. And what he discovered was that Stirling's series for the factorial, itself diverges factorially. So here's a factorial and its Stirling series. We all are familiar with it. Now, meanwhile, between the submission and publication, Euler wrote very extensively on divergent series, and he wasn't bewildered at all. He very clearly understood that divergent series are coded representations of functions which have to be interpreted somehow, and he provided a number of different interpretations. This view was not popular, and there's the famous diatribe of Abel. Divergent series are the invention of the devil, and it's shameful to base on them any demonstration whatsoever. And, of course, irreverent and probably apocryphal graffiti like this one, 2 plus 2 equals 5 for sufficiently large values of 2. Okay. Now, the next stage in the development, as I'm presenting it, was the Astronomer Royal Airy, who wanted to understand interference fringes in the rainbow. Now, I'm speaking about these fringes that you can see about half the time when you look at natural, real rainbows. And he realized that this was a fundamental physics question at the time, because he wanted to know how waves behave, wave optics, near the singularities of ray optics, which are the caustics, focusing regions, and that's what a rainbow is, as Descartes had discovered before. Now, in terms of a rainbow crossing variable, he discovered the function that describes this interference, and here it is. It's the Airy function. Most of us are familiar with it in various different contexts. It's a function of the rainbow crossing variable, Z. There it is. Now, here it is. We call it up now like we call sines and cosines. But Airy was unable to compute this function outside this little range. So he couldn't calculate these oscillations and the decay on the dark side, and therefore he couldn't compare with experiment. This, physical experiments which had been done. So this little curve was the limit of what he could do in a numerical experiment. I won't go into the details of that, but it was actually quite tricky for him to compute the integral. So what was lacking was asymptotics. How does this function behave on the dark side far, on the bright side far? And this was provided by Stokes a decade later, and he found beautifully, clearly, approximations. Let's look at the dark side. He found that this is what the Airy function does for large values of z. In terms of this variable, which will come clear later, it's negative on the dark side. There it is. And it's a series. But he realized that because of the behavior of the coefficients, this series diverges. And if you plot the first few terms for some value of z, 5 or so, I can't remember, then the terms will increase after they decrease. Okay. Just to make a point, we should recognize Stokes's brilliance in deriving these formulae. For the dark side, he pre-invented what we call the WKB method, and on the bright side, he pre-invented what we call the method of stationary phase for integrals. Very, very clever. Now, most people would be very satisfied with this, but he was not satisfied because he saw a problem, which I call the puzzle of the two exponentials. On the dark side, there's one exponential. On the bright side, there are two which interfere to produce the oscillations. How can this be for the same function? He worried about this problem for a decade. Here are the two exponentials. And on the dark side, one is very small. On the bright side, they both have the same modulus, but they're complex, so they can interfere with each other. And he realized, we'll explain why, that if you go around from the dark side to the bright side around the back of the rainbow in the complex plane, so to speak, then there's a line at 120 degrees where the small exponential, where the second exponential appears. One exponential here, two there. And what's happening on the Stokes line is this F thing that I wrote down is positive real. And that means that the second exponential, the one that isn't there to start with, which would be exponentially large if it were, is now exponentially small. And there it appears. And then he did beautiful numerical calculations which showed directly that you really need this phenomenon to happen. He looked on both sides and did... I wish I had time to describe his calculations, which I've reproduced, but I don't. Now, this is the quietly beating heart of asymptotics. It's Stokes's phenomenon. The sudden appearance of a small exponential while hidden behind a large one, going from dark to bright without passing through zero. Now, it occurs throughout asymptotics, in integrals, differential equations, integral equations, difference equations, series, near more general types of caustics. Here's a more general caustic. Here's the what's called a fold singularity across which you get the Airy function, as I've described. Here's a cusp. And you get the Stokes phenomenon for all the functions describing these local neighborhoods. So the cusp, for example, depends on two variables, x and y, and there it is, and here's the function. And does it have a Stokes phenomenon? Yes, it does. And unlike the Airy function, it occurs also for real variables. So with Airy, as I've shown you, here's the complex plane, and there's a Stokes line. Here's another one there, the Stokes set. In the case of the cusp, here's the caustic, the bright thing that you see. One real wave, one complex, three reals here. But as you go in further away from the caustic, one of the complex waves disappears. We're left with one real wave, which is a complex exponential. So your real wave is a wave that's not evanescent. And so this phenomenon is very widespread. Now, these are contrasting phenomena. If the exponents you're dealing with are I times some phi, where phi is a phase, then the caustics, where the function, the object, is very bright, optical fields, focus fields, is where real saddle points collide with each other. Now, what does that mean? That's focusing. That's the envelope of families of rays, you get two real waves becoming one evanescent wave. That's a complex saddle. And what happens there is that the waves themselves are stationary points of the phase, but you have the additional condition that the second derivative, or the Hessian, if they're more than one variable, must vanish. That's a violent phenomenon. That's why these caustics are important. However, a gentle phenomenon, far away, very different, is on the Stokes set, and that's where an evanescent wave disappears in the presence of a dominant wave, and the condition there is a non-local bifurcation. Two distant saddles have the same real part of the phase. Now, Stokes's argument was this. It was that if you take an asymptotic series and go down to the least term and you forget about what's left, which diverges, that represents an irremovable vagueness. It's the best you can do, and the small exponential can occur only when it's smaller than this vagueness, and that only happens near the Stokes line. That's a clever argument. We now know it isn't right, and we have a different picture, which is that the second exponential is born from the resum tail of the divergent series. And I wouldn't be telling you this were it not for the fact that the mechanism by which this happens is universal. The natural variable is the difference between the two exponents. And the least term in these series is of the same order as this large variable. So you have a series, and you want informally divergent infinite series. You want to separate the head from the tail, and you want to understand the tail beyond the least term. Now, you need for this the asymptotics of the asymptotics. That's large N as well as large F. And there, we encounter universality for the first time. This was work of Dingle, my PhD supervisor. I didn't realize the importance of what he did until a quarter century later. I worked on a different problem with him. By the way, he told me that when he was a postdoc in Cambridge, he supervised the quantum mechanics class attended by Abdus Salam as an undergraduate. And it was a source of amazement how quickly, instantaneously, almost before the problem was set, Abdus Salam had solved them. Okay. And Gaston Darboux. Now, why should the high orders be universal, and why should they be factorially divergent in many, many cases of series of interest in physics? Because the class of approximations being considered are usually local approximations, and so the higher terms involve more and more derivatives. And high derivatives of a function have a universality discovered by Darboux, which they are dominated by the nearest singularity of the function to the place where you're looking at the high derivatives. Now, this is a huge simplification. Anyone who works with an asymptotic series that arises in a real problem, not just the standard functions of analysis where you have explicit forms, knows that series terms are very, very complicated. Here's the 20th term of a particular series for the Riemann zeta function. Here it is, high on the critical line. Now, it involves derivatives of another function up to the 60th, also rather hard to calculate. Well, all of this simplifies down and very accurately is approximated if you go high enough in N by factorial. So that's universality. We'll come back to this later. Now, what does it tell you? Well, that's the asymptotics of the asymptotics of the asymptotics, and that's resumming that tail, bearing in mind this universality, by Borel summation. And that gives you an integral. Tidying things up, here's the Stokes line in the F plane. It's F real and large. And crossing it, where the exponential appears, is crossing the real axis. Okay. And a small exponential is born. It isn't born suddenly, of course not. These are continuous, smooth functions. It's born according to a universal scaling law involving an error function. And I'll illustrate that just for Airy. Here you have Airy, which is big near the Stokes line. You subtract off the dominant exponential, which is also big. You get something small. And you multiply again by something big, the large exponential, and then you get something universal in terms of an error function of a natural scaling variable, which precisely involves this Stokes crossing combination. And you can test it out, actually, with Airy. I don't want to go into this. These are two different examples, different values of the different points on that 120 degree line, but you see very beautifully you compare the exact calculation and the asymptotic, so degrees very, very well, and describes to a higher order what's actually happening. You've captured the behaviour. Now, that's the error function and the Airy function. But there are many applications of this. The error function occurs in Bessel functions, hypergeometric, gamma function, wherever you've got a Stokes line. Even in the error function itself, integrals with coalescing saddles, Riemann zeta function. And in physics, it applies to reflection of waves by refractive index gradients, histories of quantum jumps, I'll show you in a second, particle pair creation. There are papers about that, where this Stokes phenomenon occurs and this behavior note clear. Breakdown of slow manifolds in systems that are slow and fast. There are many examples. I'll just show you one before I get on to the deeper stuff. This is about the histories of quantum transitions. You have a Hamiltonian, it varies slowly. So you start in an eigenstate, you'll make transitions to other states. They'll be weak because you've gone slowly, but still the transitions will be there, exponentially small at the end of the process in the slowness variable. But how does this exponentially small transition arise? What's the history of it? Well, it happens near place where, in the complex time plane, a Stokes line from a certain type of singularity crosses the real axis. So let's have a look. Okay. I've shown you the transition probability is a function of time in a number of different cases. Now, you always go from zero to something exponentially small, zero to something exponentially small, but the history depends on the basis you use, and that depends on the order of adiabaticity that you use to define the basis with which you represent the two quantum states, the one that you start with and the one that you make the transition between. And it's very, very sensitive. So here you go at the zeroth order basis, just the eigenstates of the instantaneous Hamiltonian as it changes, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and always you go in the end from zero to something exponentially small, but finally at the optimal order, in this case, it gets worse thereafter, you agree quite well with this error function. So the surprise is the enormous sensitivity of the history of this process, which you could observe in experiments with in NMR, to the basis you use. Well, let me go on. Mathematicians have traditionally not used this kind of asymptotics. They've used a definition that's due to Poincaré, which is based on summing a series to a fixed order, like the seventh or something, and then looking at how the remainder behaves when the large parameter becomes large. Now, that's fine. It's given rise to a lot of rigorous mathematics, but that can never capture exponentially small terms. I think this was the one false step that Poincaré made. Worse, it doesn't distinguish between divergent series and convergent ones. That may be an advantage in some cases, but not when you want to understand divergence. Now, supra-asymptotics, as I'm calling it, is summing to the least term and asking what happens at this lowest order of exponential smallness, what Martin Kruskal called asymptotics beyond all orders. But hyper-asymptotics is going much further, and this is based on the principle of resurgence, discovered by Dingle, and in part rediscovered and greatly extended by Jean-Écal. Dingle again, there's Jean-Écal. And it's this. Series don't diverge for no reason. And the divergence must reflect the cause. Well, what is the cause? The series multiplying each exponential, there are several of them, and each of them you can calculate their separate series, must diverge in order to reflect the fact that actually there are other exponentials not captured by the, not obviously captured by the series for each of them. More than that, much deeper, each component series must contain, coded into its high orders, information about all the other exponentials and all the terms in the series that multiply them. Now, in the case where there are only two, like Airy, the two series are essentially the same apart from alternating signs. And here you see a resurgence formula. The high orders are the factorial I've described already, plus a smaller term involving the next, the first correction to the basic basic series, then the second term and the third term. So the zeroth, first, second, and third terms of the series are all implicated in successively more accurate approximations to the high orders terms. Now, the hyperasymptotic scheme, of course I won't describe it, I don't have time, for a given sum, is, and here's the sum, the tail, no it's not, the whole sum, excuse me, with a large parameter, is a series of series. Primitive asymptotics, just the zeroth order. Now, for many years, I was proud to call myself a first terms man. I didn't realize the significance and the interest in going to these high orders that I then learned. Or you can sum to the least term. That's supra-asymptotics. That's the zeroth, the lowest first hyperseries. But then you can get a Braille summation in many, many wide classes of cases, an integral representation for the remainder. And you can get an asymptotic series for that. Well, that too will diverge, so you stop it at its least term, and that gives you the next hyperseries. And then you go further, because that too you can write the remainder of as an integral, and you can calculate that as an asymptotic series, and so on and so on. This procedure was envisaged by Dingle, and he did a few exploratory computations as were available to him in those days being the late 50s and early 60s. And then Chris Howells and I developed this more systematically later. Here it is for the Airy function. I'll just show you that first. You calculate, these are the terms of the successive hyperseries. So the zeroth stage gets you down to supra-asymptotics. The first stage, the second, the third. These are the logarithms of the successive terms. And for Airy function of about 5, you get down to about 10 to the 18. This process doesn't go on forever. You can make it go on forever at the price of some inelegance. But as I've described it, the successive hyperseries get shorter. It's a kind of renormalization of the large parameter, which gets essentially smaller and smaller. Good. If you want to, for more interesting problems, more than two exponentials, there's a graph structure of the higher approximants. And I'll just quickly show you. If you have a multi-saddle integral, here's a case where there are several saddles, you have an integral through that saddle. And then, where am I? Then you have contributing at the next order, the exponentials correspond, the series corresponding to the saddles that are adjacent according to a certain topological criterion, which is all of the saddles which are reached on descent paths from your saddle as you vary the phase of the large parameter. And then, of course, when you go to higher orders, you get the non-adjacent saddles begin to come in, and eventually you have to include all of them. I'll show you how that works very quickly. It's my last technical transparency. For the PSE function, x and y, two particular values, never mind, an integral goes through the second saddle. There are three saddles. It's a quartic polynomial. There they are. A sequence of scatterings among the saddles, and here you are. You have supra-asymptotics. There you go. Then the next order, you have paths from 2 to 1 and path 2 to 3, 2 to 1 to 2, etc., etc. And eventually you get extremely accurate numerical approximations here. The error is 10 to the minus 12. You get a large number of increasing digits every time. Now, the legacy from Euler, Dingle, Ekau is this, from Stokes's insistence that you have to understand how the rainbow's dark side is connected to the interference fringes on the bright side. It's this. A divergent series is not meaningless. It's not a nuisance. It's an essential and informative coded representation of a function. Now, this was work essentially from the 1990s, but a great deal of new mathematics has emerged, starting from resurgence. Many people are involved here. In particular, my former student and now a professor at Southampton University, Christopher Howells, has extended the technologies that I've described here to integrals with more than one variable. And what's different is the topology. Many of the other ideas are rather similar, factorial divergence, resummation, etc. But now, and to my great surprise, I learned this a couple of years ago, there's another rebirth of this subject, and that's why I've talked about this history here, because divergence, resummation, resurgence now appears in applications in field theory, quantum field theory, and in string theory. A number of papers, one by Ed Witten, who's here, and others by names of people you will know. So this subject be reborn. The difficulty, technical difficulty, is immense, because it isn't just a question of integrals of double, quadruple. It's integrals in field theory with infinitely many variables, and it could well be that things are a bit different there. And indeed, there was a meeting in CERN a couple of months ago where these matters were extensively discussed and elaborated. So just a slightly pretentious conclusion, but I have to say it, I regard this work as a small step in humanity's long progress of struggling to understand infinity. You know, of course, even the idea of a convergent series took a long, several millennia to develop. The idea you can add infinitely many things and get a finite result was deeply puzzling for a long, long time. And, of course, Cantor with his different infinities, well, with divergent series, a little bit more progress. Thank you so much.
Questions, comments?
It's very late. We're all hungry, and we want to hear John Schwartz.
If there are no questions or comments, thanks to the speaker again.